Okay. Keep bringing your stuff from Pato, we thank you. But no sofas. You bring a sofa, I might fall asleep on. Missionaries of the month are Paul and Pam Chittikittiotti. They have Paul has a ministry. He does wood carvings and he goes ministers to the men's group predominantly. But they go to the Ukraine and they minister there. They do a lot of good stuff. Paul and Pam Chittikittiotti. If you want to give, you can put it in the box. We don't pass a plate. VBS meeting after the AM service on Sunday. Men's breakfast, is that on the 9th? I think he moved it.
He moved it again?
You might want to ask him.
All right.
Well, you get it on the 9th, then you get it on the 13th.
February. It's the 13th, I think. Saturday, okay. March, April.
The one at the top is
fixed. The one at the top is messed up.
So what day is it?
It's the 13th.
13th, I guess.
It's not February.
I think we need to still check.
Okay.
Well, if Sunday's the 7th, well, I guess
it's the Saturday. Yeah.
Saturday, okay.
Yes.
I'll check.
Resurrection Sunday schedule, sunrise service approximately 6 a.m. whenever the sun comes over the mountain.
6 o'clock.
6 a.m. Then 7 o'clock brunch. 9 a.m. Sunday school. 10:30 regular worship. To include the Lord's Supper and no evening service. The Friday following Resurrection Sunday is the marriage conference. Still looking for people. If you want to sign up to help in any way, shape, or form, you can sign up in the foyer. For the Easter brunch, there's a sign-up list. For men's elders conference, our meeting is on the 15th. We need to do some more stuff. In between Resurrection Sunday and the Marriage Conference on Wednesday, there's the Awana Kids Carnival. There's no evening service that night, because I'll be helping in the carnival. And if you're able, we would like you to do that with us.
We could still use a few more people.
Yeah.
You just tell me what time of men's breakfast starts.
7:30. And then I'm going to meet with hospitality this Sunday, prior to the PM service at 5:30. Okay? All right, is that enough? Anybody need anything repeated? All right. What are your prayer requests? Will?
Healing for Joyce Morton.
Joyce Morton is home, and she's had this surgery on her scalp, and I think she goes back tomorrow to cover up the hole in her head. So pray for Joyce, pray for John as he ministers to her. Pray for Patty who's helping there. Another area of concern is Marsha's daughter-in-law, Leslie. What do they call it when the baby's crooked? They used to call it...
You mean it's crooked in the morning?
They used to call it breech, but now I think they call it trans... They have another word for it now. The baby's not ready to come out, but it's time for him to come out. So they're going to break her water in the morning. So pray for Leslie, okay? Marsha's daughter-in-law. Others? Yes, Kathy?
A friend, Evelyn Avery.
Evelyn Avery.
She's having some very serious neck issues, and she's having surgery tomorrow. They've got to fuse and put plates in C2 through C7.
Neck surgery. Rhonda Dupy is having surgery on her neck on the 9th. Rhonda Dupy, neck surgery on the 9th. And we'll do an anointing with her Sunday morning. Others?
Thank you.
Yes. Yes.
My grandson Riley needs some prayer. He's in search of a new job, and he's not real outgoing, so it makes it hard for him to go put himself out there to look for a different job.
All right.
He's told me today he's got a lot of anxiety over the whole thing.
Well, that's what we're studying. We have to send one out, right?
Yeah.
Others? Riley looking for a new job, grandson Riley. I heard Roy is at, Ray's at work.
He went back for half a day each time to see if he could build up.
Really?
See what took place.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well,
amen.
Still waiting on the MRI results, though, on the heart valve. So that's very important.
Okay.
What does he do?
He works at
APCO.
APCO, the electrical. Consortium, whatever they call that. Yes, Kathy.
Tribal Mercies is our friend Hazel and Dick head back to Kingman tomorrow.
Going back to Kingman, huh?
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Kathy.
Still pretty cool in Kingman, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah. The year outs left. I think they left Monday. They text me, they were in Idaho or somewhere this morning. Looked cold to me. The mountains were full of snow. All right. Anybody else? Nobody? Yes, Kathy.
You need to remember Anita's mom?
Rosemary. Yeah. I think she's going to have her surgery now.
That's what I heard.
That's the latest I heard.
She was going to have
it. Had you heard that, Arlene?
No, I haven't.
I believe she's going to have her surgery. Anybody else? All right, let's stand. Let me pray for us. Father, we just come before you, Lord. We lift up this time. We ask, Father, that you help us, Lord, to open our hearts, open our minds. Help us to see what you desire for us to see. Lord, we bring these prayer requests before you, those that have been spoken and those that are still on our heart. You know all our concerns, Lord. You know our heart. You know who we are. You know everything about us. So we just give this time to you. We give these requests to you. We know you have a will and a way, and we accept that will and way for our lives. We just want to be founded and grounded in you. So be with your people, be with the kids tonight as they study Scripture. We pray that those seeds will be planted deep in their hearts, and we look forward to seeing what that will look like in the future. We lift up their families, and we lift up those that teach them. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, so lesson number two on anxiety. And we began to look at reasons last week that we worry. Reasons we worry. And we started to focus in on the idea that worry arises from a failure to understand something about God. Worry rises from a failure to understand something about God. And the first item we discussed was that our worry is a failure to understand divine priority. Divine priority is the word in your outline. That God has a purpose for our life that fits under His divine priority. The simple idea is this. If God gave you your life, and He did, and if He wants you to live, and He does, because you're alive, and if He brought you into His kingdom, and we can go by that assumption that He has done that, then does God have a purpose for you to fulfill in His kingdom? Yes, He does. He has a priority for you. He has a purpose for you, and He will sustain you in that fulfillment. All right? I mean, it wouldn't make any sense for God to say, I'll save you, I'll give you eternal life, I'll give you spiritual life. I have a purpose for your life and a destiny and a plan and a purpose. I've gifted you. I've called you. I've laid out circumstances in your life. And you can just keep yourself alive to deal with all that stuff. I have other things to do. Does that make sense? No. That's not the way it works. In all honesty, people who are not in the family of God come and go and live and die with absolutely no contribution to his divine kingdom. But those who are his are fulfilling a divine purpose, and that's why we can say with the psalmist, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me through the valley of the shadow of death. Do you know why it's the valley of the shadow of death? Because it can't touch you. You're saved. It's just a shadow to you. You can come out on the other side. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the psalmist wrote. All speaking to God's divine priority for those that believe in him. All right? So if God gave you life, and he did, and if God redeemed you, and he did, and if he has a purpose for your life, and he does, then he will provide what you need to survive. And to be rich to God, so to be rich towards God, you will have the promise that you're rich. So to be rich towards God, you have the promise that he will be rich towards you. Do you understand what I'm saying? If you lay up your treasures in heaven, he's going to watch over you here. And when I talk treasures and when I talk richness, I'm not talking materialistic things. I'm talking spiritual richness, okay? I'm not a prosperity preacher. And I believe that God will be lavishly rich towards you when you lay up your riches in heaven. So as long as he has this unfolding plan in your life, God will, in your outline, the word is sustain it. He will sustain you. We have a life. We have a body for the purposes of God. We've studied to live to his glory, to fulfill his will, to fulfill his plan. And as long as his plan is operating, God will sustain us. As long as we're in his will, he's going to take care of us. Do you need to build a bigger barn? And a bigger barn? And a bigger barn? Do you need a bigger barn to take care of yourself, to protect yourself? No, you need to be wise. You need to be faithful. You shouldn't be foolish. You need to be a good steward. You do need to plan for the future. But you're not the one who's obligated himself to your care. God has obligated himself to your care. That's one of his promises. You don't need to hoard stuff so you can survive in the future. You will be sustained by the Creator until his purpose for your life ends. God will feed you in all ways until the very, very end. You know, you could divest yourself of everything you have. That wouldn't change God's commitment to sustain you until it's your time to enter into heaven. So you have to understand God has his priorities. And his priority in your outline, the word is spiritual purpose. His priority serves a spiritual purpose. And if you understand that, if you understand that God has gifted you, he's called you, he's regenerated you, he's put you into his family, he's put you into a place of witness and ministry and service, and all he wants you to do then is to live to his glory, and he'll take care of your life. You know, your life isn't about your food. Your life's not about your clothing. It's not about making sure you can survive. That's God's commitment to you. That's his priority. And if you understand the divine priority, that is that you live and exist for the purposes of God, and that God will sustain your life until that purpose is fulfilled, then you don't have to worry so much about stuff. Worry fails to understand divine priority. Questions? comments. I don't think I would make that broad of a generality.
Or do you think that in the condition that we see them here in Benson and elsewhere, where we travel, are we to consider those things, are we to consider the fact that they're not just completely dead, God taking care of their needs?
God's taking care of their needs if they're a child of God. But we don't know if they're a child of God.
You know, a lot of this troubles me, Pastor, because I have stopped on the side of the road, in restaurants and on the streets, bought food for these people and prayed for them, and I have a pretty good sense of people in terms of whether they're putting me on. And a lot of these people will earnestly grab my hands tightly as we pray for them. And there is God there. And so it sometimes disturbs me that when I look around my life and I see what I have,
I can say the same thing for most men here as fathers and leaders of their homes. How come I'm singled out? How come Tommy's singled out? How come John's singled out?
And yet we have these people on the streets who crave the prayer that we bring to them. And yet, there's no relationship between their lives and ours.
Mm-hmm.
And
so, when we're all in the time of need, when somebody else around us, we receive that prayer as much more mercy than otherwise, and I think we just spend the night outside being cold and making food, like the record is that.
So would it be far-fetched to say that it might be God's purpose for someone to be destitute? And in that purpose, then, he uses you to bless them and them to bless you?
Oh, it's always a blessing to me.
Yeah. I don't know. I think there's some examples of that in Scripture, aren't there? I kind of think like John the Baptist, living out in the wilderness, eating bugs and stuff. Now, John the Baptist did that purposefully. And some of those people, I think, do that purposefully. Conversely, some of the I've known people in the church environment. I'm sorry to tell you, there's people that professionally prey on churches. They call you. They will try to connive you. They will try to take advantage of your generosities. They'll ask you for this and they'll ask you for that. And my position has always been to err on the side of generosity. But sometimes the Lord just says, hey. You know, and we even do that as an elder body. We've given and given and given, sometimes to the point of being taken advantage of. But Lord knows all about it.
I guess in wrapping up my point, the longer I live, I become increasingly troubled when I read Scripture and the life that I'm living, even accounting for the centuries that have passed, in no way, and I would say that's true for everybody here, in no way resembles the lives of the early Christians who were really persecuted, who were just like what happened to Paul and all the rest of them. And so I have a sense at times, and it's somewhat depressing, that, and I just say this flat out, when I'm reading that scripture, there are times I weep
because I feel that we are so disconnected from the lives that Jesus Christ asked us to live.
I agree. But there will come a time when we will be more closely associated with those lives. As we get closer to the end times, as the church again is persecuted. Because what does persecution result in? Purity. Always. Every time there's persecution, when God's people are persecuted, it causes purity. The problem in the church today is there's a lot of posers. So, what can you say? You know? But there'll come a time where the posers won't want to pose anymore. Because the persecution will be so severe, they will not want anything to do with it. It will not be advantageous. You know, I don't know. You know, I was associated with a church where there were numerous businessmen that went to that church, and I felt with several of them that the only reason they went to that church was for business, the connections. It was the church to be in. And then when another church became the church to be in, they went to that church, and so on and so forth. So I understand what you're saying. I think of, you know, I've not really worried too much about other people. I look at me and I say, I pale in comparison to these people that are in the Word who were 110% sold out to Christ. Really. So, I know what you're saying. I appreciate it. Okay, so secondly, another thing about worry, another thing, first of all, we've talked about that worry fails to understand God's divine priority. Next, I want to look at that it fails to understand God's divine, in your outline, the word is provision. Provision, okay? It fails to understand divine provision. Verse 24 in our scripture today, all right? Verse 24. Are you with me? Luke 12:24. We're opening new territory here. But consider the ravens. Does anybody have a different word? Some versions will say crows. For they neither sow, nor do they reap, which have neither storehouse. They don't have a place to put anything. They don't have a barn. But God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? Now, you know, why pick the birds? Well, birds are kind of fragile, you know. They're here one minute, they're gone the next. And they are a great illustration, if you think of it, about divine provision. Are they going out and working? Are they getting a paycheck and going to buy food at Safeway? How do they get their food? Whatever God gives them, that's how they get their fill. Do you know that? And I believe that every crow that ever lived, every raven that ever lived, whatever bird you want to use there, God wanted them to live because he provided for them. And however long God wanted them to live, that's how long they lived. And God, if God feeds birds in the way that he feeds birds, in a limited way. And do birds give God glory? Yes, they do. I saw a little red, I think it's called a Mexican parrot. It's one of those birds that they don't want to build a subdivision down the road because it might scare off the Mexican parrots. Pretty little red bird. Of course, it was a male bird. Pretty little red bird. And I had to add that part. But they give God his creation glory, don't they? They're so pretty. Some of them. Roadrunners are very interesting. So they give him glory, maybe not the kind of glory we give God. But God makes sure they can get to eat, right? So you would think he would make sure he's going to get us to eat. This same analogy is used in Matthew 6:26. I'm pretty sure. And what this is this is a rabbinic way of teaching from the lesser to to the greater. And you will, if you would went through the Bible and looked at the teachings of Jesus and Paul, they both often use analogies that are based upon going from the lesser to the greater. Here, it is the birds in comparison to mankind. If I provide for the birds, how much more will I provide for you? Okay? And, you know, I think it's true. Jesus is probably teaching where? Is he at a schoolhouse? He might be at a synagogue, but he's probably teaching outside. And what's flying around? Birds. Look at the birds. He's probably pointing at a bird as he teaches. Very agricultural society. And wherever there were fields, there were bound to be birds, crows. That's why we have things like scarecrows. And there has always been a problem with birds in Israel. Do you know why? Because it is the major migration area between Europe and Africa. And the birds will sweep in from all over Europe and even from Asia, and they will come down, and on the right of Israel, on your left, is the desert, and on the other side is the Mediterranean Sea, and in the middle is the most fertile valley in the world. It's called Israel. And those birds migrate through there, different birds migrating through there different times of the year. And do you know that there have been more Israeli pilots killed by bird strikes than by enemy pilots? Wow. More fighter pilots have died being hit by birds than being hit by enemy fire. At the two major airports, Tel Aviv and Ben Gurion airports in Israel, they have done migration studies. They've built alternative watering places to try to get the birds away from the landing field so that they don't clog up their engines. And if you remember, what happens in Revelation after the war of Armageddon, the battle of Armageddon? Who eats all the bodies? The birds. Might be an indication that that battle takes place during a migration. But birds are everywhere, and Jesus said, you know, look at those birds. They don't, do they sow? No. They're out there, you know. We're working, we're slaving, we're plowing, the farmer's putting seed in the ground and watering it and all that. You know, Karen's taking care of the flowers out front. Birds, they don't do any of that. You know, they're just eating whatever they can find, whatever God, they're totally dependent upon what God will give them. What's provided by their creator is all they have. They don't have the ingenuity or the capability. That all they have is instinct. Now, that doesn't mean they don't work, because I've never seen a bird laying down on its side taking a nap. Have you? That would be the only way. If you watch birds, do they ever stop? Man, they're always moving. Relentless in their search for food. If one bird gets a big chunk of food, the other bird will try to chase him down and take it from him. So we're not talking about not working. You know, we're not talking about, one thing we're not talking about here is the idea that because God provides, you don't have to work. Okay? God's provided you with the resources. He's provided you, generally speaking, with the capability to work and to gain things. And if we're in a situation where even our best efforts, we can't provide for ourselves, then God will provide for you. But birds work, and we should work. And it's what God providentially provides. Job 38:41 says, who prepares for the raven its nourishment when its young cry to God and wander without food? And the answer there is the Almighty does. Psalm 104, verse 25, there is the great sea and broad in which the swarms without number animals both small. You ever think about what's going on under the water? Who's eating who down there? There's a lot of stuff going on down there. So God provides for the animals so that they can survive. And I think he probably is a little bit more concerned about us than he is the animals. Psalm 145, 15, the eyes of all look to you, you being God, and you being God give them their food in due time. You do open your hand that you satisfy the desire of every living thing. Psalm 147, 9, he gives to the beast its food and to the young ravens which cry, speaking of God. So that's the point. God feeds them, the birds. God feeds them. He has a purpose for their existence. What do birds do? They fly around, they eat seeds, and what do? They fly around and drop seeds. And that's one way that food is carried from one place to another. So there's a glory in that. There's a delight that comes from God, from that. So God feeds them, and he provides there's a provision for us with him too. And if you look at the end of that 24th verse, that's what it says. Of how much more value are you than the birds? You're of much greater value. If God sees to it that the birds have food, don't you think he'll see to it that you have food? So you don't need to worry about whether or not you're going to have enough, whether you're going to have enough now, whether you're going to have enough when you retire, whether you're going to have enough in the future. You shouldn't worry about it. You should prepare for it, but you shouldn't worry about it. But your God promises to sustain you to the end of his purpose. And when that comes, when the end of your purpose comes for God, it's time to go, isn't it? You wouldn't want to outlive your purpose. Thomas Watson, who's a Puritan preacher and author, said, "This life is like an inn, I-N-N. You spend a couple of nights here, you spend a couple of nights there, but you never forget where your home is in heaven." Paul, to paraphrase, said, "It's nice to be here, but I'd rather leave and go and be with Christ. But I'm going to be here because I have to be here for your sake." But he also knew, as he got towards the end, he said, "I finished the course. I've kept the faith. I've run the race. I'm ready to go. The time for my departure is at hand." And until that day, Paul knew how to live in abundance. He knew how to live without. And God always supplies his needs. If I could be half as faithful as Paul, I'd be something. So, powerful arguments in those first two points. Life is from God. He gives it. He sustains it. He makes provision for it. Just as way of contrast, something else. If you go back to Haggai, you know where Haggai is? If you go to the end of the Old Testament, go back three books, Malachi, Zechariah, then Haggai. The first chapter of Haggai says this. The Lord says, the Lord speaking to his people, he says, "Consider your ways. You've sown much, and you bring in little. You eat, but you don't have enough. You drink, but you're not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves, but you're not warm. And he who earns wages to put it into a bag with holes." Now that's God talking to his people. Does that sound like his provision? No, it's not. Why? Because it continues, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways," he says. That means take a look at yourself in the mirror. Take off that film off your mirror. Look at yourself. Why are you like this? Why don't you have enough food, enough to drink? Why aren't you warm? Why do you stick your money in a bag that has holes in the bottom? Verse 8, he says, "Go up to the mountains, get some wood, and rebuild the temple." What's he telling them? Who have they forgotten? They've forgotten God. And then God says, "That I may take pleasure in it and be glorified." You know, you looked for a lot, but indeed it came to little. And when you brought it home, it all blew away. And that's the issue. Why do you do that? And he says, "Because my house is in ruins while every one of you runs to his own house." What does that mean? They were more worried about their house than his house. What does God say about that? not the way it's supposed to work. They're taking care of their own house. And back in verse 4, he says, is it time for you yourselves to dwell in your paneled homes and this temple to lie in ruins? Verse 10, the heavens above you withhold the dew and the earth withholds its fruit. They're going through a drought because God has cursed them. Very little grain, very little new wine, very little oil. God had made it all go bad because they had abandoned him. So God gave you life. He'll sustain that life. He'll provide it for all you need if, there's a caveat, if you continue to honor him, right? The Lord's providence and food supply is staggering when you really think about it. Think about the food of the earth. Do you know that there's enough food on the earth for everybody to eat? Absolutely everybody. There is a renewable food supply that is self-perpetual in nature, that there's enough food on the earth for everybody to eat. The planet has the potential to provide for the whole world. This whole idea that there's not enough food in the world is part of Satan's speaking into people's ears. So what's the solution to not enough food in the world? Eugenics. Kill those old folks. Sterilize women. Kill children in the womb. That's the Satan solution. You know, famine has nothing to do with the capability of the planet to produce. Have you ever gone to India? You know who they feed the grain to in India? The rats and the cows, both of whom are sacred. So they will be feeding rats and cows, and there'll be children starving on the streets. Communism, socialism, where people, the incentive to work is taken away, people don't work. People don't farm because they don't have an incentive to farm because they can't get ahead. They don't have a future to look forward to. And so their farmland lays fallow and it becomes a dust bowl. The earth has a great potential. It's filled with food. God has created a boundless supply. And he provides for his faithful people. That's why David said, I've never seen the people begging bread. I never seen the Lord's people begging bread. If you belong to him, he takes care of you until his work for you is finished. Psalm 34:10, they who seek the Lord should not be in want of any good thing. Young lions lack and suffer hunger, but not those who seek the Lord. Isaiah 33:15, he who walks righteously, speaks with sincerity, rejects unjust gain, and so forth. And then it says, his bread will be given him, his water will be sure. God takes care of his children. So why worry about life's necessities? Have you ever known any missionaries that have given up everything to go into the missionary field? They weren't worried about their provision. They were worried about what God wanted them to do. Worrying is a failure to understand divine priority. And that is this. The priority is that you're here as God's child to fulfill his divine purpose, and he'll sustain you until that end. And it's a failure to understand his divine provision when you worry about it. If he takes care of these animals we've spoken of, who only nominally give him glory, how much more is he ready to give you? Okay? Any questions or comments on that section? Yes, brother.
And she is very questionable now.
That falls under the category of why do bad things happen to good people?
Right.
Why do bad things happen to good people? For the glory of God. It has to be for the glory of God.
Even though we might not see
we may not understand it. Maybe. You know, I've had to talk to kids about their parents that have died. I had to tell kids about that. I've done a lot of counseling with people that have lost loved ones. And sometimes God removes people because of what lies ahead of them in their future.
I have told them that.
Amen. And children are a gift of God. They are a gift of God. But the Word tells us that our next breath is not guaranteed, right? Mm-hmm. No one. And that's why it's so important to preach the Word, to declare the gospel.
I've come to accept that that's the reason that my grandson was taken. That whatever was going on inside of him, what would have happened might have been terribly worse. And
amen.
So, but I'll tell you what, that's a tough thing for his mother.
Amen. That's a tough one. But see, everything... Ultimately, everybody gets to make choices. How do you respond to the negativity in your life? And to glorify God means that you would be drawn closer to Him. And, you know, it's a tough question. It's a tough situation. But it would be God's desire that your wife would be drawn closer to Him in her time of sorrow. Because who's the healer? A great physician. It's all God. He has all the answers. We may not want to hear Him sometimes, but He has all the answers.
I like the word choice. The word choice.
How you respond, yeah.
Fifth grade Sunday school. And, you know, I've told kids and I've told adults, you have a choice to make a bad day good or a good day bad.
Amen. Amen.
That goes for basically anything. If you have if something goes bad in your life, you've still got a choice of...
Amen. Yeah. You know, some of the happiest people I've ever known are people that had nothing, relatively nothing. You know? They made a choice. They got up every day and decided to live their life for the Lord. You know, I've got two brothers that have actually have very, very little. Both have lived their entire lives in the ministry. And both of them, one of them, his home is an old RV that he drives around the country in. And my other brother, he's over 70 years old. He doesn't own a home. He pays rent. But I don't think they would have changed anything. Relatively speaking, they're both very happy. And that doesn't mean they've had easy lives, because they haven't. But relatively speaking, they're both very happy, because they both feel like they've done what the Lord wanted them to do with their lives. So, amen. Good question. Good point, brother. Thank you. Anybody else? Yeah, but yeah. There's a little bit of difference. My brother's RV has a faded brown paint job on it. It reminds me of one of those vacation shows, you know, Chevy Chase. Yeah, RV. All right, let me see. I might be able to get through this point. I'm not going to get through, but third point, worry is a failure to understand divine, and your outline, the word is privilege, divine privilege. Look at verse 25. It's interesting. Which of you, by being anxious, can add one cubit? Your Bible might say to his stature. Some will say to your lifespan. You know what a cubit is, right? What's it? It's a measurement from the tip of this finger to to your elbow. That's a cubit. Supposed to be approximately 18 inches. Of course, some basketball players could be a lot more than that. But at this time in history, a cubit was considered from the tip of your finger to your elbow. That's how they measured, was in cubits. And what this is saying is, if being anxious, is it going to add to your height? If you're anxious, can you add to your height? Can you go from 5'10 to 7'6? I wish. So there's no point in worrying, is what he's saying. There you go. And in the other alternative explanation of this verse, because there is some commentarians thinks it referring to stature, as in height. Some commentarians think it pertains to lifespan. But by worrying, are you going to increase your lifespan? No, you do the opposite, most probably. But that, how tall you are is determined by who? God. It's part of His divine privilege. He gets to do those things. How long you live is determined by who? God. It's part of His divine privilege. So you do not have the privilege to determine how tall you are. You can stand on one of those, you can put you on one of those stretchers like they used to use in the Middle Ages to stretch people apart. You might gain an inch or two, but after that, you're going to be in trouble. The Lord gives, and what else does He do? He takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord, you know. You know, a lot of people will tell you, well, you got to do this and you got to do that, and if you do this and if you do that, you'll live longer. You know, we have a mega billion-dollar industry in America over supplements and vitamins and exercise and medications and on and on and on. And I'm not saying you should ignore any of those things, but I don't think you should worry about it. I really don't think you should worry about it, okay? I don't think you should have anxiety about it. Some people are consumed by their health. I believe you should be disciplined about your health. I think you should be moderate in the way you eat, unless it's a really good steak, and then you should eat all you can.
This is going to be a tough sell for you, brother. It's going to be a really tough.
Yeah, the part about food is. But worry isn't going to lengthen your stature or your life. So it's all determined by divine privilege. So don't worry. You belong to God. The priority is for you to serve Him. He makes provision so that priority can be fulfilled. And He determines exactly how long He wants that to go by His divine privilege. It's all up to Him. My computer just skipped about 5 pages. So, any comments in regards to privilege? Anybody? Nobody? I found it. You know, it's critical we understand who our God is, really. So, do you know Christians that worry all the time? Yeah, you can go through your Christian life worrying all the time. And usually the reason why you can do that is because you're ill-informed, because you don't go to a church that teaches you the nature of God or the character of God or the promises of God or the purposes of God. And so you get cheated out of that, really. You get cheated out of peace and patience. You lose some of the comfort of God because the evil one wants to take that away from you, because the evil one wants Christians to look like who? Everybody else. Wants those Christians to be wound up. And then the only other reason why you might be a worrier as a child of God is out of ignorance. You just don't know the Word. And if you have a hard time with worry, I would tell you to read one book of the Bible to start with. It'll take you 150 days. It's called Psalms. And if you read that one book, you'll get a picture of a God that you won't have to worry about anything. and you'll get to know him as well as you can know him. Because when you function in ignorance of God, if you know God and you worry anyways, that's not necessarily about ignorance. That's about your not trusting him. In the outline, the word is distrust. You need to trust the Lord that he'll provide for you. Amen? All right, I'm going to stop there. I had about 7 more pages, but it's good to have the comments, though. I appreciate that. And they were good comments, so keep it up. Anybody else? Uh-huh. You know, there is a definitive word for that procedure, and I don't remember what it was. Yeah. I know I've read that too. All right. Amen. Amen. Yeah, God never designed Christians to worry. And all you got to do is look at his word. You know, worry is, there is concern, but you know, when we're defining worry here, is worry that incapacitates, that causes anxiety, panic attacks, things like that. That's what we're talking about. God didn't design his people to live that way. He's designed them for victory. Victory. All right, let's all stand. Thank you for coming. Appreciate you. If you weren't here, I'd be talking to myself.